Welcome to Beyond the Gloves, Episode 3. I'm John Sable, and as usual, joining us is Billy Strange. And not as usual, joining us is Paul Coleman, Chief Game Designer of the DiRT franchise from Codemaster. Paul, thank you for being here, and how are you today?
I'm doing really well, thank you. We've had a long day at work, so still guys down in the studio working hard on the project, but I've gone upstairs to do this recording with you guys.
Yes, thank you. And again, yes, thank you for being here. I'm curious, just kind of jumping right into things, as now we're getting to about, 5 months from release for DiRT 4. Is this when the nights start to get a little bit later for you guys, or are you pretty good at, I don't know, everyone not working too much?
We've been working pretty hard on this one. We went for a pretty ambitious project, big changes in our technology. So we've actually arrived at a point now where we're starting to tie it all together, but it's a little bit later in the process than we'd have liked that to be. I think traditionally, because we've been using tech and tools that we've been quite familiar with, we've been able to basically have a really good handle on where we should be in the project and not have to do, it's not crunch, but it's certainly longer hours to try and close out the areas that we need to close out so that we can really start the polish phase of the project. So yeah, we've got guys working hard in the studio making sure that we can deliver on the promise that we made when we announced this game.
Gotcha. Curious, how many guys on the team are currently working on the game there in the studios?
So I think at the moment we've got about 75 in-house, and then probably that goes up to about 125 when you include externals. We've obviously got an offshore studio out in Kuala Lumpur who does a lot of our art production work for us. We've got some other help outside the studio as well. So yeah, we're still running at pretty much full capacity, trying to get this closed out. So yeah, it's back to big project, big team.
Gotcha. I'll stop talking here. Billy, what say you?
I'm a little more curious about the, it looks like, at least from what I gather, you've been with the DiRT series from when actually DiRT started. So after the Colin McRae series was the, 03-04 in 2005, and then DiRT started. So why don't you kind of give everybody a little bit, our viewers a little bit of a rundown of your experience throughout the DiRT series?
Yeah, so it all started when I was at university studying automotive engineering design. I started playing Colin McRae Rally and Tocker touring cars in my spare time with friends while sort of staying in dorms, and kind of fell in love with racing games kind of changed my direction on where I wanted to be in life to get into game development, but found out the Codemasters were literally just down the road from Coventry where I was studying. So kind of did everything I could to change the course that I was on and the direction I was going in to make that happen. Actually joined Codemasters in 2003 as a tester. I think the first game I tested was Race Driver 1, right at the very end of that. Then rolled straight onto Race Driver 2, and then the first Colin McRae game I touched was Colin 2005, which was obviously the last of the Colin McRae Rally games. And then I spent a bit of time in a sort of external studio where we'd evaluate external products when Cody's was more sort of publisher and developer. I worked on a huge number of projects there, but didn't really do much with them. It was more just kind of evaluation work, and then an opportunity arose to become a junior designer in what was then Juice Studio, but is now the Racing Studio, and that was spinning up what was at the time called Colin McRae 6. But over the course of the development of that game, we changed to DiRT. Certainly, we called it DiRT for you guys out in the States. I think we called it Colin McRae Rally DiRT over in Europe.
Correct. Yeah.
Sort of towards the end of that development, actually, I left Codemasters to work on Sega Rally briefly. And then Codemasters bought the Sega Racing Studio when that project wound up. And I ended up working on DiRT 2, DiRT 3, Dirt Showdown, and then more recently Dirt Rally, and now Dirt 4.
So if you can remember, do you remember the reason for the change to the Dirt name instead of still calling it Colin McRae? Was that to appeal to a wider US audience, or?
It was to appeal to a wider audience in general, and to us, that territory that wasn't really tapped into was definitely the US. So introducing short course racing and getting Travis Pastrana involved in the series as well, they all spoke to going broader with it. I think it's fair to say that the company wanted it to probably go more North American in its feel, but the development was so far along that we were kind of already making a Colin McRae game at that time. So we did change some of the content in there, and to be fair, Colin was going out and competing in the X Games, so there was, you know, some kind of relevance to doing it. It wasn't just us doing a land grab and trying to get the North American audience on board by throwing content at the game. So yeah, like Rally was getting pretty boring back then. Sebastian Loeb was kind of winning everything. And you know, we were looking at ways of capturing more than just Rally in our product. And I think looking back, it's pretty fair to say that it was a wise move. The Dirt franchise kind of took off from there. Dirt 2 was a massive game, huge production values, like really awesome project to work on, really good fun to make. Dirt 3 was us kind of trying to appease some of our Rally fans by bringing more of that content back in. Showdown was obviously a spin-off, and I guess you could describe it as a bit of a business necessity. We needed to fill a hole in our release plan, and it was something that we needed to do. Actually, it was a really fun game to design. It wasn't a particularly fun game to make because the development cycle was pretty tight. I think we went from high-level design to shelf in 9 months, and I don't think there's many people that have made games that rapidly.
And in this day and age, that's pretty amazing. I mean, to go
with
games now that take like 5 years plus to make, and trying to turn something around like that in 9 months, that's pretty impressive.
Yeah, it was brutal. I mean, there was pretty bad attrition within the studio off the back of that. So then when we finished Showdown, I started looking at prototyping what was then going to be Dirt 4, and the rest of the studio went off and made Grid 2 and then Grid Autosport. And during that time, we were able to kind of look at the vehicle simulation and really start to think about what it was to drive a car off-road again. I think we'd been going from product to product to product, and we hadn't had that opportunity to really crack into our simulation engine and get to the bottom of what it is that we need to get that feeling of the cars right. And it was a long process. At the time, I was co-driving as well for the first time, so I was starting to get an experience of the sport firsthand. And that sort of insight that I gathered, that knowledge from speaking to rally drivers, finding out what it was that made a rally car such a special vehicle to drive, all started to pervade into that prototype. And that's essentially where Dirt Rally was born. It started life as essentially just a handling model test bed, but then we started to build some tracks into it. And you know, there came a point where the business had this prototype and they wanted to test the water with it, but we didn't feel like it was going to be a mainstream enough product to really go big with it. So early access was the perfect launch pad for that. And I'm delighted that it was a much bigger success than I think anyone was expecting at the time, even myself. And so that set us down the road for Dirt Rally, which was a hugely exciting thing to work on, you know, from a development perspective, being able to interact with the community at a level I've never really had before. Obviously, I've spoken with the fans on Twitter since 2011, but being able to see their feedback come in and then actually implement that in the next patch was, you know, hugely exciting. And that is absolutely what we've built Dirt 4 on, that's very solid community-driven foundation. So I know that when we announced Dirt 4, I think there was a bit of, I guess you could describe it as a bit of a murmur of discontent amongst those core fans that helped us build Dirt Rally. And so, you know, a lot of my time over the last 3 weeks has been spent on forums, doing Reddit AMAs, essentially trying to explain to people that, you know, this is Dirt Rally at its heart. But what we are doing is broadening out this franchise to the mainstream audience that DiRT has always been renowned for appealing to, but without, you know, dumbing anything down or essentially muting that great experience that we'd captured through that prototype that became DiRT Rally.
And that's got to be a fine line to walk. What did you take from DiRT 4, or I mean DiRT Rally, into DiRT 4 as far as community feedback? How do you go about that process where you take the things people really liked, the consumer really liked, and the things that they disliked? And I kind of like the thing that I was listening to another podcast where Pete Hines from Bethesda was doing an interview with Greg Miller, and he talked about Todd Howard's process about look at the problem when they have a problem. You know, they're coming up with a solution, but you don't want to focus on the solution, you focus on the problem. How do you guys go about making the next iteration from DiRT Rally to DiRT 4? How does that process work?
Well, the first step was just to look at what people wanted and what we couldn't do for DiRT Rally. Now, some of that was budget, some of that was resource, some of that was tech. And certainly everything from a tech perspective that was a limitation, we have tried to go about resolving. Now, you have to draw a line in the sand when you're making these games, and there are certain things that haven't made the cut, but I think that the absolute biggest thing, and it's something that has haunted me as a game designer from ever since I've been involved in choosing what tracks and what cars we put in the game, and that is the number of tracks that we could physically make for a product would never satisfy the demand of our consumers. It's been a problem that I've faced, and you're essentially doing kind of bread and fishes with track choice throughout a career mode or through online modes or whatever. There's always that limit where players are going to learn the tracks, they're going to get bored with them, and it's especially poignant in a point-to-point racer. I think with circuit races you kind of get away with it because the idea of turning laps is what racing is. And for those core guys, doing a 75 lap race is, you know, as compelling for them as the guys that just want a quick 3 lap sprint, but the track is still the same and all you have to do is change the number of laps in the settings and you kind of got both audiences locked down there. But for us, point to point, you know, every kilometer we make is more expensive than any kilometer you would put into a race circuit. And yet, our fans demand hundreds and hundreds of kilometers. And so, you know, the biggest thing for us has been trying to address that problem. And that's something that we started talking back in 2011, just after DiRT 3 had finished, about how do we, you know, address this issue of content, certainly from a track perspective. And that's where Your Stage was born. Started life as essentially an exercise on pen and paper. And then it became like a board game, essentially, where we'd roll dice and see what the system gave us. And actually the kind of response we've had to DiRT Rally and that passionate community that we've kind of fostered through the release of that has given us this renewed confidence in Rally as a sport. And what better way to kind of give something back to that community than give them a near infinite amount of tracks to drive.
So taking a little further deep dive, how does that system work? You know, you guys went about making that board game type of a process. How do you implement that into DiRT 4? And you may not be able to get into it now, but how you talk about an infinite, essentially, options there.
Yeah, so
how does that translate?
So it's about 10 to the power of 43 or something, and then we stopped counting, and that was without bringing in like weather and condition variation into that. So it is okay. A big number, even for our brightest boffins. It's basically like the way I describe it in layman's terms, it's like the best Skeletrix set you could ever imagine. But it's a pretty complex system, and to be fair, we've been pretty cagey about how it really works because we don't want our competitors to kind of base any prototype that they might be thinking of on the work that we've done. But essentially, the pieces of the puzzle that we have many, many different variations on them, and we can populate those pieces with many, many different assets. So that's trees, organic stuff, but also it's non-organic stuff like houses and signposts and water splashes and gates and all of that kind of thing. And so these pieces get laid out across a landscape and the road finds its own route through that. So this isn't track creation, it's track generation. And essentially the system is seeding from a start point and then working its way through a landscape based on the parameters that we're allowing the player to use, which is a slider for length and a slider for complexity. And so the infinite, near infinite possibilities that that affords us are astonishing. We're seeing tracks that we would never have dreamed of designing, certainly not in a situation where we have to pick the 100 best kilometers of stage we can pick. You know, now we're able to do 3 kilometer long straights and not worry about the fact that that's burning our resources, because the straight pieces have been made and they kind of fit together and weave their way through the landscape. So yeah, we're seeing moments that we would have never designed. That's not to say that these pieces are just running wild. We obviously curate them closely and make sure that the system is giving appropriate stages that you would expect to find in these environments. But if you're excited about driving a new stage and having to listen to your co-driver and really tapping into the essence of what it is to be a rally driver, then this is absolutely a system that's been designed around that. And I think from our point of view, where other games like Gran Turismo have done similar systems in the past, but it's been part of a much bigger product where they've had a lot of other stuff to worry about, because rally is our focus. And yes, we obviously represent rallycross and short course and other disciplines as well, but rally is the core of what we do. We were able to really double down on the investment for this and make sure that this speaks exactly to what we're trying to solve, which is the lack of content in our games.
So I'm curious, with going and piecing together all those different, you know, corners, straights, what have you, to create these tracks, was it a challenge then syncing up the co-driver's calls for this system, or was that something where once you're able to develop the system for the co-driver, it essentially falls into place just like the pieces of the track does?
A little bit. There were challenges to overcome, but I think the fact that I do co-driving as a hobby allowed me to think of it from a kind of real world experience perspective rather than a game developer's perspective. And so I was able to explain what was required, and the team that I work with were able to provide solutions to the problems that you know, the new system exposed. Ultimately, when we recorded the co-driver calls for DiRT Rally, we put more effort into that than I think we've ever done in any of our games before, and that includes when Nikki Grist worked with us on the early Colin McRae games. You know, every single corner was recce'd multiple times. We wanted to absolutely nail in that feeling of getting every bit of detail we could through the notes. And so when we did do the recordings for that, I would sit in the D-Box motion seat and the stage would be driven live, and I was actually reacting to the actions of the driver. So when you hear those kind of slight hesitations or false positives in the calls, or when you can hear me getting shaken about as you're bouncing down some fairly hefty bumps in Greece or in Wales, that's not acting. That's me getting shaken about in a seat and
oh, that's cool. Yeah.
That intensity getting brought through my diaphragm and into my voice. So we learned a lot from doing that. But obviously with pieces, you can't have that sense of ebb and flow that perhaps the DiRT Rally recordings captured. So what we actually did was record Nikki sat in that same seat, getting shaken around a lot, but take multiple takes and go through every single call that we would need. Because ultimately for DiRT Rally, to get those calls working in game, we had to cut them up into segments so that we could time them according to where the player was on the stage. And that's exactly the same system that we're employing here. It's just that those pieces can be broken up in whatever order we want. So we can't then deliver it with an ebb and flow that's very prescribed to how we recorded it, because that would come through and sound quite disjointed when you hear it in a different order. So Nikki did an outstanding job, and Jen Horsey as well, who's done our North American calls, both did an outstanding job of kind of keeping it as level and as calm as they could while getting shaken around in the seat. so that we could capture the essence of what those calls should sound like. And, you know, I don't want to kind of get too boastful here, but I believe they sound as good as the DiRT Rally calls, and certainly better than any other product that's out there at the moment, in terms of their realism and their flow, despite the fact that they're getting cut up and brought together in a different order through our Your Stage system. So yeah, it's something that's obviously very close to my heart, as I do it for real. So delivering on that aspect of it was very important, because ultimately, if we're saying to the player, you've never seen this track before, you have to listen to your co-driver if you want to be fast, that co-driver has to be excellent and flawless.
Yes, yeah, yes. No, be boastful. Be boastful about it. I think it's pretty, well, in all seriousness, I think that's pretty impressive to be able to try and relay that in a believable manner while still conveying, hey, we are in, you know, this racing title that we're still trying to direct you. We're still trying to help you succeed in a manner. So yeah. I be as boastful as you want cool. On that one.
we're amazing. Let's just put it that way.
There you go.
There it is. That's what we like to hear.
Brush it off the shoulder. Going back to the how your stage works, does each location have a different way that it tries to figure out the route? Because what I didn't understand before in some of the stuff that I had read is I didn't realize it was the environment that would change too. I kind of figured it would be like tile-based or maybe like a section of a map. And then you said, okay, here's all the pre-planned, like, houses and trees and bushes and all that. Oh, okay, and we have these many routes to go around, and then here's this part of the map over here. So this sounds more involved than what I was imagining it. So how is each location kind of the same, I'm going to be very reductive here, algorithm, or is it different per location?
Yeah, it's so we take different landscapes for each location. In fact, each landscape has multiple landscapes within it. And those landscapes are made up of different zones. So we've got forest zones, we've got towns, we've got open moorland, we've got farmland. And so we know where those zones are marked out on the landscape, and then we're able to choose the flavor of tile profile that we can then drop onto that. So the routes that the system finds through those landscapes will be different based on those zones, but it allows us to know that that is essentially the same topography that you would expect in a forest or in a mountain region. So yeah, very much so. If you look at the way that the landscape works its way through the kind of farmland and forests of Australia, or the moorland of Wales, or the snowy forests of Sweden, compared to then how it works through the mountainous region of Spain, cutting it in and out of towns, it's a very different kind of algorithm that has to work in each location, which adds character and flavor to each of those areas. So this isn't just we've colored it in differently. This is very much, you know, the guys have done incredible work getting this system up and running and making sure that it delivers on its potential. We always said when we decided to push the button on doing this that we had to essentially create tracks that were at least as good as what we had in DiRT Rally. And that has been a challenge, because I think it's fair to say that the stages that we had in DiRT Rally were some of the greatest rally stages that have ever been created in a video game. So it was quite a high benchmark we set for ourselves. But yeah, we're not in this for an easy ride. We wanted to do something that genuinely challenged everyone in the studio, and it absolutely did. You know, my hair is a lot thinner than it was at the start of this project, but you know, it's been worth it.
Curious, so since it sounds like your stage that processes is taking a lot of different bits and pieces, has load times been a concern, or is that something that we shouldn't worry ourselves with?
Load times is always a concern for us. I mean, when you move these games onto console, you have to make sure that the load times are under a minute, or you're going to fail your submission, or at least have to have a very good explanation to Sony and Microsoft as to why they're over a minute. On PC, it's not a problem at all. And obviously, the more powerful your rig, the more likely it is that you'll be able to rip through the loading and get to your track nice and quickly. When we were working towards the announced demo, We managed to get our longest stages on PlayStation 4 loading in about 45, 50 seconds, and the shorter stages are around the 30 seconds mark. So it's not ideal. Obviously, we're going to try and optimize that as much as possible. But you know, we're confident that it's well within the parameters of what is laid out by the platform holders. And obviously the PC master race will be able to have quicker loads based on the performance of their own machines.
Going to kind of transitioning a little bit into DiRT 4's single player. I believe you talked about a single player campaign. When you hit the rally stages in that, is it using your stage, or do you guys have you implemented or put in an actual stage? Just like, I'm not saying it's like what was in DiRT Rally, but the idea that DiRT Rally had.
So we're actually using your stage for it, but we're curating the tracks that we're putting into the career. So as a game designer, it's always been a frustration of mine that the tracks that we did end up choosing as the tracks that we would make in the game had to suit all levels of players and had to be accessible enough for the newcomer and challenging enough for the more core members of our audience. And I think if you look at games like DiRT 2 and DiRT 3, they were probably quite wide, pretty gentle on anybody who considers themselves a serious racer, but were probably a little bit too challenging still for the more casual members of our audience. If you look at a game like DiRT Rally, where we were absolutely uncompromising and took the stages verbatim from the roads that we knew existed within the world of rallying, they were brutal. They were actually probably what made the game hard. I think if you took any of our DiRT Rally cars and put them in a nice open playing field, they would be quite nice to drive. I mean, these cars are four-wheel drive. They're based on production cars with slightly higher performance and more trick differentials, but ultimately they're a joy to drive. You should be able to chuck them around and have a lot of fun with them. So it was our tracks that kind of really made us, I hate the term, but the Dark Souls of racing games. So yeah.
There's nothing wrong with that.
So what we set out to do with your stage was to create a system that allowed us to curate all levels of the experience from within it. And so as a designer now, I can make sure that the tracks that are in the early championships of the career are nice introductions into the world of stage rally that will still have exciting moments. And if you're pushing the car to the limit of its performance, you will always be racing on the edge, but shouldn't feel like they're just brutal with, you know, sheer drops off to the side or trees super close to the edge of the track that are gonna, you know, take you out of the enjoyment of just getting to grips with a car. But then further down the line, we've got stages that are almost certainly more brutal than anything you would have seen in DiRT Rally, because when you crank those complexity sliders and length sliders up to the max, you know, the challenges that await you are right up there with the hardest stages in Wales and beyond. It's just the perfect tool for me as a designer to curate this career mode, and it means that every stage you go to will be different. Yes, obviously you can go back and do events again. You'll be able to replay stages that you've enjoyed. You'll be able to save them as favorites and share them with your friends. So that's a fantastic part of what we're doing. So you imagine the leagues that you could do in DiRT Rally now factor in the fact that you can generate your own stages and create your own championships and set people off on tracks they've never seen before. You know, the opportunities are amazing, but you know, it starts from that simple problem that we had, which was how do we get an interesting and varied career for our players with as many tracks as possible. So yeah, absolutely, it was important for us to have it within the career mode.
I'm curious, with the new style of your stage of building the tracks, since now you don't have to go through that pains that you talked earlier about making these longer stages, are we gonna see some very long stages that are well beyond what we saw in DiRT Rally?
Sadly not. I think one of our limitations is how much length we can put into the environments, because ultimately we're building this on similar tech to what we had before. It is something that we'd definitely like to address in the future, but right now our longer stages are about the same length as our longer stages in DiRT Rally. But when the complexity's cranked right up, that means that where in Dirt Rally you drive for 5 minutes, 50 seconds in some of the faster cars through Wales, now you're getting about 9-10 minutes of playtime on those tracks, because you know you're dealing with a lot more technicality than you had in the moorland sections of our Welsh tracks. So yeah, that I think I always look at this from a how much time do you spend on the track rather than how long are you driving or how far are you driving. But yeah, it's absolutely one of our long-term goals to try and increase that cap as much as possible, to the point where ultimately it's down to you as a player to decide how far you want to be driving for.
In kind of addressing the brutality, you know, we poke a little fun at saying Dark Souls, but or you could even say Neo, the new one. But the having newcomers, that was always what was hard for me to get somebody into Dirt Rally to begin with. And then once I got them going, then it was like, okay, I understand what's going on. But I know when I first tried it, you know, when it, because it released in early access, I got on the stages. I was like, holy cow, what am I doing wrong? Because I consider myself fairly adept at dirt surfaces. And I was having a hell of a time until I kind of understood what Dirt Rally was trying to communicate to me and go, you're trying to push this too hard. You need to back up your turns. You need to change the way you enter into the sections. You got to listen to your co-driver much more than you're used to. So is that concern for the newcomer when we're getting into Dirt 4? Is that kind of the idea with Dirt 4? You know, you're saying you're curating the stages in the single player. You know, how, I guess the better question is, how do you approach making it accessible for somebody that is on the console with a gamepad, and then that transition, did they get a wheel, and then beyond?
So my first experience of sim racing was Jeff Crammond's F1 GP. That showed me that even as a 8-year-old boy on a keyboard on my mum's home computer, I could drive an F1 car. And then as I got better and better at that, I turned the assists off and then got a wheel, and it just became more and more sim. But at the beginning, you know, I was driving around with auto braking on and everything, and the racing line, and it taught me everything I needed to know about loving racing beyond what I'd just been watching on the TV. I've always been passionate about cars, but I've never really been fast. That was for me one of the best expressions of taking players by the hand and leading them into the experience. So it frustrated me, and it still frustrates me, that with Dirt Rally we didn't get the opportunity to do enough of that. It was uncompromising, it was brutal, and while I may have appeared unapologetic about that, it hurts inside that I couldn't do more for our players that were excited by rallying, who love the sport, who wanted to get into it, but perhaps didn't have the understanding or the skill set to take that step. So absolutely, it's been one of our primary concerns for Dirt 4, and it's so much more than just curating the tracks in the career. We want to take players by the hand and lead them into this experience. So the way that you are introduced into the game through a welcome event, and then you'll arrive in a rally school where you'll get to try your hand at all the various techniques. So rather than just being shown a video and told what to do, you're now actually going to have the opportunity to try these techniques out and see what difference it makes as you do different things. We're not going to be judging you with like bronze, silver, gold pass rates or anything. This is just about you familiarize yourself with a car and cars, because obviously the different drive types make a big difference in rallying. You try stuff out to your heart's content until you're ready to leave the open area that is Dirtfish. I don't know, you guys probably know Dirtfish better than we do over here, but it's a nice open area rally school where you can get to grips with these vehicles. And then we take you into your career through exactly the types of vehicles that you would be using if you were working your way up through the junior ranks into the more professional levels of competition. And then you get to do all the other disciplines, and then you get to go into the historics and really delve into the history of rally and experience the stuff that the players that did enjoy Dirt Rally really got to experience full on. So this is, it's kind of an education for any player that's new to this and is excited by what they see of rallying, but perhaps hasn't had the opportunity to learn what it is to drive one of these cars. One of the key ways that we're doing that is up front, we're offering the players a choice of, do you want to play with gamer handling or do you want to play with simulation handling? Simulation handling is basically what we had from Dirt Rally with all of the feedback that we got from our players that we weren't able to address in Dirt Rally. So we've cranked up the aerodynamics systems. And when I say cranked up, that's not we've increased the aerodynamics. That is, we actually model it properly now. And while aero is not hugely important in rally cars, obviously it's getting more important in the 2017 WRC cars, but it's not hugely important. It does make a dramatic difference to how the cars fly through the air, how they crash, how stable they are at speed, and what happens to the car when you slide. Obviously, sliding a car through a stage does do all manner of things to the aero on the car and how the air is flowing over the car. We need to much more accurately model that than I think a lot of other games where aero needs to work with the nose of the car pointing forwards, but they can just kind of throw that out the window as soon as you start going sideways. But I mean, you guys know what happens to a NASCAR if it starts going backwards and the flaps don't deploy, it gets airborne. So we need to be thinking about the attitude of the car a lot more than perhaps other games do. So that's been a huge innovation for us. Suspension geometry as well, massively improved. So now all the different rear-wheel drive classic cars have their suspension types and their axle types much more accurately modeled to represent how they interact with the surface. So you should feel the nuance and the difference between an M3 and an Escort much more than you ever did in Dirt Rally. And then tires and surfaces. Rallycross tire has seen huge step forwards to make sure that that progression from the cross-ply tire is so much more apparent. And you know, Petter Solberg, double world rallycross champion, has definitely validated the feeling is so much better in rallycross than it ever was. And that's also our tarmac tire for rally has been improved. I don't know whether you guys are going to be fully satisfied with it. Obviously, we're going up against, you know, simulation engines that can purely focus on what it's like to drive on tarmac. So, you know, where we have been able to focus on making stages, our tire model has to be so varied for all the different surfaces and surface types and conditions that we have to spread our technology a little bit thinner than I think a lot of other games need to worry about. But that has seen an improvement. So all of those areas, for those guys that love Dirt Rally and wanted more from it, have been improved. But if you're a newcomer to the game, or if you love Dirt 2 and Dirt 3 and you just want to get back into the franchise, that's where Gamer comes in. It still has that core simulation model underneath, but we've done loads of stuff with all of our experience that we've had from working on more simcade, arcade, call them what you will, titles. It's all done with the controller. It's all done with managing the weight shift for the player a lot better. Extra tech like helping the player with their braking. That's not auto braking, that's just helping them with their braking. All of these layers that just essentially make the driving experience a lot more palatable and a lot more accessible. But yeah, what I want is for players to feel like they should be turning this stuff off and getting to grips with what the cars really feel like. But people will turn away from an experience if it's way too challenging right off the bat. And you know, the frustration for me with Dirt Rally was you'd get reviewers kind of going, well, if you don't like hard things, don't even bother with this game because it's hard. Now other players saw that as a huge challenge and dove straight in, and we saw, you know, a great reaction from those guys. But for the people who are put off, who don't perhaps have the time to invest in learning those mechanics, you know, they were just like, why would I spend hours crashing and getting frustrated when I can be off playing something else? So yeah, it's absolutely about addressing that, but it's a multi-pronged attack on how we can address these various ways of getting players excited and interested in the sport that ultimately we love.
Cool. Something you noted on a couple minutes ago about all different technology. I'm curious how game design has evolved from when you first started with the DiRT series. And I have to imagine, well, I would guess, I guess you'll let me know here, that it has to be almost more difficult these days because you're taking in so much information thanks to technology. And then, you know, as we march more towards realism, and then beyond that, you know, another sector of technology is now you have a bunch of folks like us running around who think we know everything, who give you, you know, probably a lot more feedback than I assume you used to get. So does that all together make it more a challenge, or has game design just always been a challenge no matter what?
I think, yeah, game design is creative problem solving, and you know, the fact that we have more problems to solve and those problems are getting reported so much more frequently and by much broader audience of people, and the communication that they have with the team is so much more direct through whatever social media platform they're using, through our forums. You know, previously we were able to deliberately or not filter out that information, and people were only really able to communicate with us through our customer services hotline, which was, you know, a conduit for information, but it was always taken with a pinch of salt and not really ever treated as seriously as it is now. But you know, I sit on my sofa in the evening with my family watching a bit of late night TV or whatever, and I'm getting people contacting me about, you know, feedback that they have for previous games we've worked on or stuff that they'd like to see in the next one. And that immediacy of being able to respond to them, or be able to walk into the studio the next day and say, somebody's actually just contacted me about this. Is there any way that we can make this happen? You know, it means that a lot of the kind of the questions that you might have, or the is this idea a good idea or not, can be answered pretty quickly through feedback from the community, getting a read for what people are thinking, getting a feel for what they're saying. And you know, early access was really good for us in that respect, because not only did we act on what we thought was important, but then we were able to see what was genuinely important. Once we'd kind of created that diamond in the rough and put it out there, you know, the community were what gave us the tools to polish it, and it was their feedback that drove us forwards in making sure that what we were doing was taken to the next level.
Something else that's came up in terms of another technology, VR, it's a hot button topic, especially a little more in the hardcore scene. And I'm curious, what's your personal thoughts on VR, if you enjoy it yourself? And then how much effort is it to go and then have a VR title? And we know Dirt Rally on the PlayStation 4 tomorrow gets the PSVR update. Is it time consuming? And if it is, have you seen, I would say, enough use of it from the data that you think that it's something that you guys as a team really want to continue developing going further?
So we've always tried to be at the cutting edge of technology, and we've always tried to support whatever technology is out there, be it track IR back in the day, D-Box systems when they started working with racing games. We were one of the first studios to really support it. So, you know, VR was a logical step for us to take forwards. We'd actually been working with Oculus long before they were Oculus, I think. And so, you know, as we've seen the technology develop, we've tried to incorporate it unofficially into our games, and then obviously that became more official once the hardware was more readily available to the public. PSVR was obviously an important step for us, because testing the water with a much more mainstream platform and much more affordable platform, even though it is still quite expensive, you know, it was a really important step for us to see what the appetite is for it. Personally speaking, I have struggled with VR from a nausea perspective, but that is just, I get motion sick, and it took me a long time to deal with that from a co-driver perspective. You know, so...
Wow, that's got to be brutal. Oh yeah. My goodness, yes. Motion sickness as a co-driver.
But you can get used to it, and you can get over it. And, you know, all of the stuff that's put in place by Sony and by Oculus to make sure that the acclimatization is as smooth as it can be for players, you know, making sure that... I would never say to a player, the first thing you want to do is to jump into Finland on Dirt Rally and drive a 15-kilometer long stage. That's going to upset even the most kind of stoic kind of non-car sick person, but VR is, it's hugely exciting for racing games. I think there's definitely something for racing games that other genres perhaps don't get. That is being able to sit strapped in into a seat, be locked into a position and have the world move around you. A lot of other games, you're essentially, you know, a first person shooter, for example, you want to be moving around. It doesn't make sense if your body's moving, but you're not moving. With a car, you're strapped in, so it's okay to sit down and be motionless. Although VR with a D-Box is something else. but yeah, like it's a really cool piece of tech. We are definitely going to see what happens with PSVR and obviously continue to monitor the data on the usage on PC. I think part of the issue we have at the moment is that there are different VR platforms and trying to support them all is a challenge. And certainly from a Dirt Rally perspective, you know, continuing to invest into VR in that product is also a difficult thing to kind of get past the business side of things. So we are going to continue to monitor the situation. The cool thing is that we have done a lot of the groundwork for it. So our understanding of what's important when you're putting VR tech into a game and what works and what doesn't work are all, you know, known now. So we don't have those kind of challenges to overcome anymore. And it's more about iteration and improvement than it is about how do we even get this stuff working. So I'm not going to make any promises for Dirt 4 just yet because it's not my place to do that. But from my perspective as a developer, obviously we want to be supporting tech as much as possible. It's important to be at the cutting edge. And if there's an appetite for this, we will look at supporting it. So that's where we're going to go with it.
Okay, so just to sum up, so at launch for Dirt 4, there isn't any VR support at the moment?
No, ultimately we are focusing on getting your stage and all the other tech that we're introducing into the game working as best as it can. And to be supporting VR at the same time is going to be too much for us. So if it happens, it will be a post-launch update.
Okay.
Do you... You mentioned the different titles that you played when in your childhood. I mean, I did the same thing. I didn't have access to a PC, so all my stuff was limited to consoles. But I remember getting back into gaming, and I started with the Gran Turismo and the Toka Race Driver on the PS1. And then you had mentioned like Pro Race Driver 2, which was one of my favorite in the series, and then Dirt 2 being another of my favorite. Do you venture outside of the particular title that you're working on for either inspiration or ideas not to do? You know, do you look at a title? Do you even play anything besides? I guess what I'm getting at is, do you even play anything besides racing titles? Is there any desire to try and absorb anything from outside of the genre?
Very much so. I think if you look at Dirt 2, I designed the online mode for Dirt 2. That was my core area of focus as a senior designer there. And at the time, Call of Duty Modern Warfare was, you know, pretty much the multiplayer game to play. And, you know, we took a lot of influence from how they brought players into sessions together, how immediate those lobbies were, how the choices were made for the players. With a veto system that essentially put two choices up in front of the lobby and whatever got voted up got selected as the next map. You know, stuff like that was really important to get because we'd spotted that people had got frustrated with racing games and the fact that the all-empowered host was able to choose whatever settings they wanted and could sit there and delay the start of the next session. And so yeah, I think that's a prime example, certainly from my own personal experience, of an area where we saw a way that it could be done better and acted on it. But yeah, there's all manner of game mechanics that are used outside of the racing genre that can be introduced into the racing genre that do apply without feeling forced or kind of unnecessary. And I think certainly from the way that we've set about appealing to a broader audience, it's important to have those aspects in there. I think part of the reason why Dirt Rally was received differently to our previous DiRT games is because it was so pared back that a lot of those kind of cool game mechanics that we would have introduced were left at the wayside. So our career mode, our championship mode was very grindy, and it was essentially just keep doing the same tracks over and over again until you can afford enough money to buy another car. Now, in a lot of sim games, that's perfectly acceptable. People are just time trialing and they're playing it for the pleasure of the vehicle dynamics, but that's not enough for a lot of the more, I'm not going to say discerning gamers, but gamers who are playing games because they love games, not necessarily because they love how a gun feels or how a car drives. And so, yeah, to appeal to those types of players, you need to have better hooks, better gameplay loops, better loop mechanics. And those are all things that we've looked to address in DiRT 4 to make sure that our players are compelled to keep playing the game rather than just, you know, grinding through to get the next car in their garage.
And while you were hard at work with DiRT Rally and now DiRT 4, is there anything within the genre that you tried at all? And you don't necessarily have to say if you liked it or not, but was there any need to try anything within the genre?
Obviously, we look at what the other guys are doing in the off-road space. So Sebastian Loeb Rally and obviously the WRC franchise. So it's important to see what they're doing and making sure that, you know, we can better that wherever possible. But, you know, going broader than that, I think what the guys did with the Assetto Corsa was really impressive, super exciting. You know, they've got my car in the game, so it's like nice to be able to turn some laps without the risk of pranging it. So that's always nice. But yeah, ultimately, you know, I think it's very naive when you hear game developers saying, no, we don't look at what our opposition are doing. You know, it's ultimately you have to do it as part of the job. It's important to see what else is out there. But at the same time, you shouldn't be chasing shadows. You should always be looking to innovate. That's exactly why we brought Flashback into the genre back in the day. That's exactly why we're bringing Your Stage into the genre now. It's important to keep a defendable lead within the genre, and that's something that we're trying to do with DiRT 4.
And I imagine that's a fine line to try to keep your creative vision intact while also acknowledging. I'm not going to say names, but I have heard other developers go, I'm not worried about what they're doing. I'm worried about what I'm doing, which is fine. But I also thought there was always a need to at least know to a degree what else is going on so you don't miss out on something that all of a sudden, oh, it's passing me by now. I completely missed this opportunity to not be just the same, but be ahead of the pack.
Yeah, and to your point, I think, you know, seeing mistakes that other developers have made is a very cost-effective way of not making those same mistakes. So, yeah, you'd be foolish to just put yourself in a bubble and imagine that the world is not important. So, yeah, you have to see what's going on out there.
So, excuse me, Paul, I'll let this be my last question because we don't want to keep you all night. I'm curious about the release date timing for DiRT 4 with it coming essentially, I think, about a week before E3. Is that something that you guys are involved with at all? And I'm just kind of curious why that date was chosen. And also, is it getting to a point now with the way the gaming industry is going that, you know, putting a game out right before E3 versus previewing at E3 and then releasing it afterwards just isn't as big of a deal as maybe it would have been in the past?
I think there's definitely an element of that. I think there's a clear break between when we are releasing and the E3 event, because I think releasing during E3 would be not commercial suicide, but it would be foolhardy. So yeah, we have a fairly firm deadline to hit there and make sure that we don't slip anywhere nearer E3. But yeah, absolutely. We've always intended to make this a Q2 release, and I guess this is pushing it about as late into Q2 as you would want to, but that's because we want to try and get this game as polished as we possibly can. So yeah, there's no kind of brilliant scheme behind it other than to not hit the same date as E3 and get out there a little bit beforehand.
Billy,
yeah,
you got something to kind of have us nail this landing?
Well, no, not really. But I think that, well, it sounds exciting. I'm really excited. I'm looking forward to it. I enjoyed Dirt Rally quite a bit, and my history with the franchise goes way back. I mean, like I said, all the way back to the PS1 days when it was Colin McRae. So I'm excited, and I guess I'm just going to kind of throw it to you. Is there anything you'd like to ask us, or anything you'd like to kind of expand upon with Dirt 4?
No, not a huge amount, other than to say that, you know, we talked a little bit about the career mode. There is obviously a lot more in-depth team management. You'll be able to set your team up and brand it with a livery editor, so that personalization aspect, excuse me, is really coming back. It's a much bigger product now. We've got the full soundtrack that you'd expect from a Dirt game, but it brings all of that kind of passion that we brought to the franchise with Dirt Rally and takes it to the next level. So I'm super excited about it. I hope you guys are. You know, I watched the show the other week when you essentially called me out to come on the show. So I thought it would be good to get on board. And hopefully I've answered a few of the questions that you raised in that show, because ultimately, yeah. I'm all about just trying to give as much information to our community as possible through whatever way we can. So, yeah, it's been a pleasure to be on. And I didn't wear any gloves, sorry, but, you know.
That's okay. We're guilty of being gloveless in this.
We really should get some sponsorship sorted for that.
Yeah, we'll work on that some more. But Paul, thank you for coming on. We really appreciate it. It is really nice to hear it directly from you instead of us just, you know, doing what we normally do and just going on about what we think is going to happen. So again, thank you for coming on.
Cool. Absolutely no problem at all.
Okay, so I think that will do it for episode 3 of Beyond the Gloves. I think we maybe did it within an hour, so we saw the comments. We know
very,
you guys.
Yeah, very close.
Oh man, well then we're gonna call it good. So yes, again, thank you for watching. For Paul Coleman, Chief Game Designer at Codemasters, for the Dirt series, for Billy Strange, and myself, John Sable, thank you for watching Beyond the Gloves.